Flying at extremely low altitudes in the Ukrainian war zone is a standard for both the offensive and defensive sides of this war. Fly too high and you will most certainly be shot down by a missile. Fly too low and you would probably make it, although the risk of hitting trees, power lines, or even a truck means a similar destiny as being hit by a missile. That's why many pilots on both sides refer to their sorties as suicide missions. But flying low is not the same thing as flying under the radar. See, during the Cold War, fast jets could fly below 250 feet and mostly avoid enemy radar scans. Flying under the radar is in fact an antiquated term, stemming from the days when radars tended to look upwards at an angle because they were not effective in scanning the terrain horizontally, and so airplanes could fly below the angle of the radar scan. But that is no longer the case. So why is it that Russian and Ukrainian airplanes still fly so low to the ground? We will cover four main reasons, but how Americans in 1960 misidentified the moon as a missile threat is not what you think. The concept behind radars is quite simple. A transmitter sends out a narrow beam pulse of electromagnetic energy. When the beam hits an object that can reflect its energy, some of the beam echoes back to the radar, where it's picked up by a receiver, and after processing, the result is displayed as a blip on the radar screen. Once a target is acquired, the relevant information can be sent to anti-air systems, which can consequently launch missiles. The pilots may avoid getting hit using countermeasures, but usually the missile wins. As of November 2022, according to visually confirmed evidence, Ukraine has lost 50 combat aircraft and 22 helicopters, while Russia has lost 62 aircraft and 55 helicopters. The best mobile radar system in the Russian military is Niebo-M, which performs target acquisition for the Russian surface-to-air batteries such as S-300, S-400, Panzer, and others. Under ideal conditions, it can detect targets up to 372 miles away. But in practice, due to the following four reasons, radar performance can be drastically reduced. The majority of radars are line-of-sight systems, similar to a flashlight. Just like the beam of a flashlight cannot go around corners, radars cannot see beyond the curvature of the Earth. The radar needs a clear line of sight to the target, so if something is in the way, the target does not receive the electromagnetic wave, which means there will be no echo to detect. But if there is a clear line of sight, radars can see things really far. How far, you ask? Let's just say that back in 1960, only 2 days after the ballistic missile early warning system had become operational in the United States, there was a warning that a missile was coming toward the US. Although it soon turned out that it was a false alarm. The radars had mistakenly identified an object that was 250,000 miles away as a threat. It was the moon, rising over the horizon. Since most mobile radars, like the Russian Niebo-M, cannot see over the horizon, their detection range depends on two factors: the elevation of the radar antenna and the altitude at which the aircraft is flying. For example, if the radar antenna is 16 feet above the ground and the aircraft is flying at an altitude of 100 feet, the radar's horizon range would be 17 miles. But if that same aircraft flies at 33,000 feet, the radar would be able to detect it from 227 miles away. This is why setting up radars on elevated ground, like a hill, would make sense, since it increases the detection range of low-flying aircraft. The downside is that it makes the radar an easy target for missile strikes. I should mention that radars that can see beyond the horizon also exist, which are called over-the-horizon radar systems. But due to their large size, they are stationary structures. This makes them less relevant to the war on the battlefield, since they do not communicate with anti-air batteries on the ground. At least not yet. The second factor is terrain. Whether it's a valley or a hill, both can physically mask the aircraft from radars. Getting below a tree line or building can also do the trick. In fact, back in April of 2022, the Ukrainian Air Force successfully utilized the terrain to their advantage when they resupplied and evacuated wounded soldiers from Azovstal in Mariupol, a city that was completely encircled by Russians. Ukrainian helicopters leveraged the terrain to avoid radar detection. although after conducting a few of these missions, Russians caught on and relocated their radars, which allowed them to destroy several Ukrainian helicopters. Kyiv was left with no choice but to stop those helicopter runs. The third is radar clutter, which can be in the form of atmospheric crud or ground clutter. Anything in the atmosphere, be it rain, smoke, dust, clouds, birds, and even water vapor, can bend, scatter, or absorb the electromagnetic transmissions from radars. This can in turn dramatically reduce the effective range of the radar and further complicate the detection of aircraft against the noise. The farther the target is from the radar antenna, the bigger is the problem with atmospheric crud. Then there is ground clutter, a phenomenon where trees, buildings, power lines, and other objects on the ground reflect back the radar signal. This can make it quite difficult for radars, whether they are on the ground or in the air, to differentiate between a low-flying aircraft and all the noise bouncing back from the ground. Although the modern Doppler and look-down, shoot-down radars have for the most part resolved this issue, modern radars are able to filter out fixed targets and focus on moving targets. And yet, it's still possible for low-flying aircraft to get lost in the clutter. This is referred to as nap-of-the-earth flight, where a helicopter or fixed-wing aircraft flies at extremely low altitude to blend in with ground clutter, effectively blocking the line of sight from ground-based and airborne radars. During the nap-of-the-earth flights, helicopters can fly as low as 10 feet above the ground, but jets only fly as low as 50 feet off the ground due to their much higher speed. Once the aircraft approaches its target, it pops up to attack, and then turns back before the enemy can even respond, a tactic that is utilized by both Ukrainian and Russian pilots. Flying over roads and highways can further help to blend in with moving vehicles, especially for helicopters, which can fly lower and slower. While theoretically, airborne radars could likely detect a low-flying aircraft over roads, in reality, deploying such valuable assets on a daily basis near a war zone would be too risky for Russia or anyone else. But wouldn't a low-flying aircraft be an easy target for manpad? It would, but only if you can see the aircraft. A low-flying aircraft that moves at high speeds doesn't give manpad operators much of a reaction time. It would appear and disappear over the horizon in a mere few seconds. That said, fly too high and too slow and you would be the perfect target for manpad. The fourth reason for aircraft flying extremely low in war zones is to take advantage of multipath interference. Even if the radar signal bounces off the aircraft, the returning signal could reach the receiving antenna via two or more paths. This is because the returning signal could bounce off the ground, bodies of water, or any other object on its way back. When the same signal is received over more than one path, it can create ghost targets, which appear and behave the same way as the actual target, making it more difficult for radar operators to figure out which blip on the radar screen is the real target. For example, the radar could see three moving blips at three different elevations, one of which is the real target. This reduces the chances of the airplane being shot down. Early on, we established that flying high in the war zone is a suicide mission, since long-range radars can easily identify the target and anti-air missile systems like S-300 can shoot it down from 90 miles away. But this doesn't mean that flying extremely close to the ground is without its own risks. The obstacles on the ground, anything from trees to power lines, can pose a serious threat, especially that things like power lines are not so easy to spot. Sometimes special maps are produced that plot the routes of these power lines, but their accuracy is questionable, especially when it's in a foreign country. For this reason, nap-of-the-earth flights are mostly conducted during daytime, when visibility is high, although they do happen at night too, with the help of night vision goggles. While the exact number of crashes related to flying low is unknown, they have happened to both Ukrainian and Russian pilots.